In today's video, I'm going to be taking a look at Stability AI's newly released Stable Audio Open 1.0 model. I'll be doing a lot of sound generations and peppering them throughout the video as a demonstration of the model. This isn't going to be an expert level breakdown of Stable Audio Open, but rather a quick summary of what it took to get this up and running on Windows, some prompting and generation tips, and a little about getting the training loop running on Windows. I haven't been able to successfully fine-tune the model, but I've been able to get the trainer to run thanks to a bug fix that will probably be lost in a mess of GitHub posts. I've gotten a few questions about this model, and the documentation online may be a little confusing, so I thought it may be worth going through a little about how I've used the model here. Before I get started, there are a couple caveats with Stable Audio Open. These model weights and outputs are subject to a fairly restrictive license. While open source in name and perhaps technically correct, Stability places the model weights behind a click wall that states that the model may not be used commercially, and this is becoming quite common with machine learning models. Cookie TTS has a similarly restrictive license on their XTTS model, and as we've seen with how XTTS has been used, clearly everyone is just going to ignore that license anyway. And finally, if you're looking for a pseudo AI replacement, this isn't it. Stable Audio Open will not generate full lyrical songs. In fact, it generally shouldn't output any voices at all. The model is similar to Google's Music LM in functionality, from what I can tell. You can generate up to 47 seconds of stereo 44 kHz audio using a text prompt in a variety of common genres or real-world sounds and sound effects. The model was trained using samples from Freesound and the Free Music Archive. I think there are a few general rules for prompting that worked for Music Gen and Music LM that will perform pretty well here as well. Overall, it seems like including the instrument, basic genre, mood, tonal descriptions, use case, and speed in the prompt will get decent results. Here's a few examples of those descriptors used in prompts. There's a command line interface script, however, you may want an easier to use WebUI, which can be found with the Stable Audio WebUI. That's a familiar Gradio interface like many of the other WebUI projects out there. If you aren't interested in attempting to train this, the WebUI should be sufficient to generate clips. To use it, just create a conda environment with Python 3.10 and follow the installation instructions on the WebUI GitHub page. They worked on my system without issue, or you can try the one-click installer. These projects do change rapidly, so by the time you see this video, the interface layout may have changed. If you attempt to install Flash Attention from the repo on Windows, you'll probably encounter an error. However, there are precompiled wheels for some system configurations for some versions of Flash Attention available. These are compiled by user BDAShore3 and available on the linked GitHub repository. Select the version that corresponds to the version of Python used in your environment, the version of Torch used, and your CUDA version. For example, Python 3.10 would say CP310, and the CUDA version 12.2 is CU122, and compiled for Torch 2.3.1. Install it with pip install, and then the file name of the wheel. Now the messy bit, training. I'm not going to go into a ton of detail about the actual fine-tuning of the model, simply because I haven't been able to do it myself yet, and I probably won't be able to. However, I did manage to get the training loop running thanks to a bit of guidance from a GitHub post, and I did manage to make sense of how to get the data loader working. With that, someone with more resources should be able to get up and running. Out of the box, the trainer doesn't work on Windows. There's some issue reading files and serializing outputs. Quite honestly, I have no idea how this fix works. All of the credit goes to the GitHub post that I've linked below. The actual lines of code that were changed differ from the post, so I'll go over the current changes here. First, in the console, install dill with pip install dill. Open the dataset.py file and add import dill to the top. Locate this block of code somewhere around line 158. Wrap the config.custom metadata function with dill.dumps, and around line 270, locate this block of code. And wrap the self.custom metadata functions with dill.loads. As for the trainer, here's how I've set things up. The data config sets up the directories as well as the data loader. The model config I've copied is the one from the Hugging Face repo, which is where you can download the model checkpoint as well. The dataset config has a custom metadata loader to create the prompt. By default, the trainer code uses the input file name as the prompt, which looks like this. You may want more detailed prompts than can be accomplished with just the file name. So you could set up something to load external files like this. This will take a file with the corresponding base name and read the input as the conditioning prompt. But that's sort of all I can say about training since I can't really do any of it on my system. The model itself looks like it takes about 9 gigabytes to train, but when generating demo samples, memory usage peaks to over 12 gigabytes, which is more than my GPU. This causes the generation to slow to a crawl, and after the samples are done, memory isn't released, and then the training slows to a crawl as well. However, if you have 16 gigabytes of VRAM or more, or somehow manage to reduce memory usage, you may have better luck. Unfortunately, I can't really do any more with this myself. It should be interesting in the next few months to see what kind of developments spring up around stable open audio. Its licensing makes me concerned that there may be little attention from the open source community, but hopefully we'll see some training optimizations like low rank adapters applied to the model, which could make it more usable. Well, that's all I really wanted to cover in this one. If you found this video helpful at all, please leave a comment or press the like button. Your comments and likes are pretty much the only reason these videos get any traffic at all. That's all for now. Thanks for watching.